All right. Hey guys, it's good to be back in the studio with you. We are here with Life Lessons Live, Let's Talk Edition with the crew. And it is a great day. And I pray you've been having a great day as well. And I'm excited about our conversation today. We believe here at Life Lessons that conversations birth new seasons. And so with that, we're just here. This is no judgment zone. We've been talking in the vein of just being successful as entrepreneurs and things of that nature. And we're going to just add some things to the pot on that and talk about, you know, being effective versus being busy and knowing the difference. And I pray that we can just add some insight that'll help you along the way. We don't know everything, but we're sharing our experiences, sharing what we've come to learn over the course of our years of experience and what we've got going on right now. This is a multi-generational conversation, so we want everybody to be involved. As you see running across the bottom of your screen there, you can join the conversation by just entering something in the comment section. And when you do that, we can see it live. We'll put it on the screen, have some conversation with you about that. And we love to hear, you know, if this is helping you any. And always remember that you can go back and you can subscribe to our YouTube channel, and there are all of our Life Lessons Live shows on there, and you can definitely go back and watch all of the different ones that have been on. Also want you to know that at 5 p.m. Central Standard Time in Tupelo, Mississippi, or around the world, you can listen to us. It's a repeat of our shows, a rebroadcast of a show on 94.7 KBN radio there in Tupelo and the surrounding areas. Also, all over the world, you can listen to it, repeat version of the show at kbnradio.net, kbnradio.net. So there's no reason for you not to get the content. We pray we can be a blessing to you. I want these guys to introduce themselves to you and let you know who's in the studio with me today. You guys tell them who you are, what you do.
Hey, my name is G. Patterson, Gerald Jr. I am the owner of the Bus to Sell. owner of the Bus to Sell here at 220 South Industrial Road, located inside Words of Faith Church, Tupelo, Mississippi. And also the owner of Math Homes, where we do real estate investing. So if you guys need help, let me know.
That's awesome. Stephanie?
Yes. Hey world, I am Stephanie Monique, the voice of the Uniquely Living radio show.
All right now.
So that's where you know the voice from. So I keep having people say that to me, I know your voice. And I say, I don't think I've ever met you. So anyway, okay. And for being here on Life Lessons Live with the crew, with Bishop Gerald Patterson. So.
All right. Yeah. You're an educator, mentor.
I am an educator, a mentor. Yes.
Absolutely. Number of things. Degree person. Isn't that right?
Yeah. Thank you.
Degrees going on, all that stuff going on. Come on now.
Thank you. It's hard to talk about yourself sometimes.
I know. I'm horrible at that.
Yeah. So thank you. Thank you. Yes.
Sometimes I just want to be like, you know, I'm just G.
Right. You know, my personality doesn't, you know, require all of that. And it's hard for me to talk about. I tell our staff at the church, I said, listen, I need you all to talk about, you know, what we're going on, because that's just kind of not my thing. And we talked about staff and weaknesses. And so that's something I need to staff, because I don't do well talking about myself.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
I just show up to serve, man. I'm everywhere.
I got you. That's awesome. So listen, guys. Listen, being effective versus being busy, and knowing the difference. You know, am I effective or am I being busy? I can remember when being busy was exciting and fulfilling to me as a degree. You know, to a degree it was. I'm talking about, man, being busy, had something to do, had somewhere to go, man, you know, just running, you know, little sleep, you know, just being busy. I'm 57 now. Now we talk about multicultural generations. Now I love a good nap. Okay. So all of my steps, I need them to count. I need them to count. I need them to make sure that I am being effective. We talked about entrepreneurs. What you're doing with that talent, with that product or with that service, you got to make sure you're being effective. You know what I'm saying? I learned that working smarter and not harder. You know, I learned that when I was working with manufacturing engineers, when I was in corporate America, you know, every step counted. They talked about time is money. You know, everybody's got the same 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. Everybody's got that same time. And the difference between the successful and the unsuccessful is what they do and what their time. So that talks about effect. That brings effectiveness into mind for me. You know, you work hard all week and mm-hmm. then you look, get to the end of the week and you got a little profit. You know, that's not good. You can't keep on doing that. You can get a little challenged with that. You're working hard, man. You look like you've been busy. I can remember when I was young and I was managing in the restaurant world. And man, we would be busy. I'm talking about we running around this, Stephanie. I know you can relate to this. I'm talking about it felt like we just did something. Gee, you can relate to it too, because you were the GM, amen, of one of the businesses there in Tupelo. I'm talking about it felt like we was doing it.
Yeah.
I'm talking about, and then you run the numbers at the end of the night. What?
Sick.
then got whooped. Then got slap whooped.
Exactly. Just be sick looking at them
Just
got beat down.
You like, and you really thought you was doing something. Mm-hmm. You really thought you were doing something. And so we had a whole lot of activity going on and all of that, but we weren't being effective. That's what we learned about upselling and all that. Every customer counted, get the maximum amount out of that customer. Am I right or wrong?
Come on.
That's right.
Come on, talk about it. Talk about it. Because we had 100 people in there and we got a $3 profit.
Wow. You know, that reminds me of the times, you know, working for the pizza chain that I ran. I mean, we go through, you know, 400 pizzas in an hour, you know, I mean, mm-hmm. and in a delivery business, that's humping it.
Yeah.
And, you know, we run the numbers at the end of the night and, you know, made money, did sales, but we blew labor.
Wow. We
wasted food.
That's
you know,
so
had
rude.
A lot of mess ups, you know, had to throw up, had a lot of canceled orders and things of that nature. And when you look, it's like, man, I got dragged. I'm tired. I'm whooped. And I didn't hit my numbers, you know. And, you know, so I know exactly what you're talking about. We were busy, but we weren't effective in handling the rush and taking care of our customers and hitting our marks for the company guidelines and what they had set before us. So I understand. I could talk all day about that one.
Amen. Amen.
And just to add into that, you know, operating at maximum potential, you know, we had to learn how to what we would call bump and slide, you know, being able to train people in different positions so that they can operate multitask and putting your aces in the places, you know.
Amen. And that's good.
Making sure that you capitalize on the strengths of your team. So it requires so much more. You're coaching, you're managing, you're leading, you know, and then at the end of the day, when you finish all of that, you still got to pay the light bill and the production costs and all of that, you know, your rent, you know, for your establishment. And so, right. So the profit at the end of the day may be 50 cents. We done brought in such and such amount of dollars, but you know, once everything goes out, you know, you learn, you gotta bring in more than you export. So,
yeah. That's good.
You know, and can you relate that to life?
Absolutely.
You know, in life, period. I mean, every area of your life, you can take some of these principles we're going to be talking about today and apply it to it. You know, I don't care if it's going to get groceries. You know, I don't care what you're doing. You need to be effective. You don't need to just be running errands. I hear people say, I've been running errands all day and they're coming in, they're going out and coming in and going out. Well, you didn't put together a plan in order to get done effectively what you needed to get done. You're just what we call ripping and running, ripping and running, wasting gas, wasting time, wasting energy. And you could have had that done in so much less time and got more and more accomplished during that day. Amen. Mm-hmm. Samantha Renee said, restaurant life is not for the faint of heart.
Listen, that's my best friend, and we have worked in some restaurants together. Do you hear me?
Amen.
Yes.
So let's talk about what effective means.
Okay.
Effective is adequate to accomplish a purpose, producing the intended or expected result. You mentioned something, G. You said company guidelines, what they're expecting for us to do. You know, do I even know what that is? Am I aware what I need to be accomplishing so I can know if I'm being effective or not? You know, it means to produce a deep impression, to be disciplined. Do y'all agree that discipline is a lot to do with making sure waste doesn't happen? We're not wasting time. We're not wasting food. We're not wasting energy. All these different types of things. Can y'all see where we got to be disciplined?
Definitely.
Absolutely. Disciplined in your consistency.
Mm-hmm.
Disciplined in, you know, if we're related to the restaurant industry, disciplined in recipes, you know, call for the specific amount of product. You know, we will portion product. That's the reason why you have these, you know, portions. Things are pre-portioned because, you know, we have to be consistent in the disciplines of making sure that we're abiding by those guidelines and those protocols and expectations. So yes, discipline is a factor.
Okay.
To increase your productivity and to be effective.
Let me ask you this. Did they even have a time that it should take to prepare a certain item and all of those types of things?
Absolutely. I worked in a full service restaurant. Very, very widely known here in Tupelo, and that's Harvey's. So the Eat With Us group.
Shout out to Harvey's.
Yes, yes, absolutely. Fair Park Grill and Peppers, those are all of their restaurants. And so they're known for creating experiences. And so, yes, you know, a time, you know, knowing, gauging, you know, what time things need to go out and the time frame that people need to eat and being aware of that, you know, it's different when you're eating dinner versus when you're eating, you know, at lunchtime. And so the return of that product, you know, that you're making, you know, you have to be ready and on point. And that does require discipline. It requires competency too.
That's powerful. G, you was a GM of the number one delivery. How did they say it? How do they call that?
If you do apples to oranges or anything, they are the number one delivery company in the world.
Right.
And that's over FedEx. That's over UPS, USPS. They are the number one delivery company in the world, which was Domino's Pizza, which still is Domino's Pizza. And I hold high respect for them. They were my college. That's where I got my degree in business.
Come on.
And,
talk about
And what Monique was talking about as far as being on time, we had, you know, we're talking, you know, in a full service restaurant, you might be talking 10 minutes, 15 minutes. Well, in the delivery world, when you're the number one delivery company in the world, you're talking 2 minutes. You're talking a minute and 30 seconds.
Wow.
You know, you're talking from prep to bake time, 8 minutes. You're talking to out the door in less than 10 and to the customer's house in less than 20, you know, and I'm blessed to say that I was one of the top operators at one time. I don't know if they still hold that record here in Tupelo, but, you know, we set some records in the company and did some things under my leadership back in the day. So that's why I hold them in high regards. But, you know, you talking a 20 to 25 minute experience.
Wow.
From the time you hang up the phone to the time that you're, you know, opening the door to get your pizza, your wings, your cheesy bread, and those good things. So, you know, being timely was we trained on speed. We did competitions where we would reward our employees for being fast, getting faster, but also not lacking in quality one bit. That pizza should look the same whether you made it. Whether it took you 5 minutes to make or 30 seconds.
Okay.
And of course, I was the best. Okay, you always get top quality when I was in the building, and I wasn't in the building, I had a great team.
Uh-huh.
So you know, but that is something that I've been able to take with me in every aspect, even now of what I do with doing phone repair. You know, I pride myself on being the best value with the quickest turnaround time. You don't wait all day for me. I get you in and I get you out, and it's going to be top notch quality for a great price.
Yeah.
And that's the equation for value. If a lot of people don't know that equation. So, you know, time was of the essence in all of the businesses that I've experienced.
Mm-hmm.
You know, even working retail, working in the mall here in Tupelo, you know, I was there for 5 years. And, you know, even in that pace of business where people are walking in and out of your stores, the conversion rate, how quickly you got a customer in and out.
Mm-hmm.
From setting up their phones to, and you had to make sure that all of their stuff was transferred and mm-hmm. grandmama's pictures were saved and little boo-boos, baby pictures was found from 20 years ago that you don't want to lose and keep. So, you know, time. If you don't respect time, then you don't respect anything. Time is the earth's commodity. And so it was very, I mean, that's been a part of my entire professional career. In working in my 30 years is time, you know, as well as being effective with my time.
All right.
It doesn't make sense to get it to you fast if it's sloppy, unpresentable, it stinks, it doesn't taste right. It doesn't matter that you got it to me in 10 minutes if it wasn't what I wanted or ordered or what I expected. So, effective.
So that's being effective, being prepared, available for service. That's a part of being effective. We talked last week, we talked about personal development, appearance. We talked about all of these things all go into a nutshell, and it makes your character. It shows whether or not you appreciate your customers. All those different types of things, what allows you want return people. You want people to return. You want people to talk about what you're doing.
Right.
Isn't that right? That's what you want to do, right?
That's
so you
right.
got to be, this is one of the first things we want to talk about. And we're going to pull some things from 7 Habits of Highly Effective People by Stephen Covey. Okay. And some things that I've added in from the Leadership Institute there we do when we teach wherever God gives us the opportunity to teach from. But the first thing is about being proactive.
Yeah.
Being prepared. Can y'all talk about being prepared?
You know, I
think of 4 things I want to mention in this preparedness, and you can pick one of them to talk about. Being prepared spiritually, you know, how much does your faith play a role in your entrepreneurial ventures? You know, second thing is physically. Am I prepared physically? What about financially? You know, financial stability. Mentally, being prepared mentally, being a student, having competence and things of that nature. So being proactive, being prepared. What can y'all speak to that when we talk about being effective?
Okay, so just really quickly, a recap: physically, mentally, financially, and spiritually, being prepared.
Yeah.
Correct.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So I do want to say this: I think that being prepared, and we talk about being proactive, being mm-hmm. prepared is one of the main things that helps you to be effective. Because Gerald said, okay, when he was talking, I was thinking about this. He said, basically 20 minutes. Okay, so we're making a pizza in 8 minutes, right? In my mind, I'm thinking the dough has to be prepped. And listen, guys, I'm not an expert about this. I just know because I've seen Gerald prepare and make pizza. Okay. And he is the best. All right.
I taught you how to make pizza.
You did teach me how to make pizza. You did. You know, but I'm trying to give you your kudos. Okay. So listen.
Yeah. We talking about Faith Cafe, guys. We had it popping.
Yes. You teach me how to make pizza. I learned how to dock it, you know, how to prep it. And so the preparedness, when you think about it, you have to prepare, you know, hours before. So they can be 24, 48 hours. And if you talk about physically, mentally, financially, and spiritually, you know, some prepping needs to go into that. So preparing your dough, putting boxes together. You know, all of these things. So the process of being prepared, thinking, you know, ahead. And I know that's one of the
mental part of that, mental faculty, competence about what you're doing.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, and then planning, knowing what you need, you know, and so that encompasses time management and knowing, you know, what you need in order to get the job done. You know, breaking those things down. So yeah, being prepared is a major part of your effectiveness.
So take this one right here. Spiritually, okay. How much does your faith play a role in you being effective as an entrepreneur? You know, if you had to say that, you know, you have people that are out here, man, they're dealing with all different types of things, and you know, they got you gotta talk about it. I don't want to talk about it. I want you all to talk about it. How much does your faith play a role in this, in being effective as an entrepreneur, successful?
Yeah, I can talk from my own experience just on today. You know, had a pretty rewarding day today, but I had to be spiritually prepared for today to gain the rewards of the day, which caused me to have to pray. I had to pray. I had to meditate. I had to fast. I didn't put anything in my mouth before a certain time. I had to, be thankful and grateful and speak to what I was praying to God for. I had to put that faith out there and be prepared to receive when the opportunity came. And I want to say this, I believe that the saying goes, when preparation meets opportunity, that's where you find success.
Absolutely.
And so being spiritually prepared for your success, when you meet the opportunity, you will be in the right spirit, not just of the spirit, but in the right spirit to capitalize on that opportunity. And that's exactly what I experienced today in my personal life and as I went working around the day. So, you know, it's very important. And a few key things, like I said, number one, prayer. You know, is the catalyst to vision, you know, number one. And so, you know, when you're praying, and praying is not only you asking God for something, sometimes it's listening. It's a two-way communication between you and God. And you know, that was very important for me today, because I had things come up in my day that tried to deter me from what I was trying to do. And that came from people in my life who I love, who I you know, think highly of. But it came with distraction.
Okay.
So me being in the right time, spirit, and spending that, and I don't want to minimize it, but that little bit of time with God today, kept me in a place where I was able to capitalize on those opportunities.
Wow.
If I hadn't have done that, I would have been off track. And that's my personal experience, just today, guys.
Let's say just today. So, yeah.
Just today. I mean, that's in every day, you know, and the better as you grow, you'll learn how to implement certain things and put first things first. You know, a lot of times we get sidetracked and we put the cart before the horse. But first thing first, you know, and it's just my personal experience, you know, and I don't want to get too deep. I'll tell you what works for me.
Because you teach
me. I just want to let them know what works for me. You know, is when I wake up in the right mind frame, when I've renewed my mind, okay, and when I've woken up in the right mind frame, I'm able to put first things first. And who's the head of our lives? In my life, God is the head of my life. And so when I give him my first fruits, that plows the way for the rest of my day.
Okay.
And that's what happened to me today. And I just, as of now, I'm just sitting back as I'm winding down and I'm thinking about what all I did today. I'm like, God, thank you, because I know you heard me. Mm-hmm. So my spirit was in the right place. That's if my good. Spirit would have been off, I know that these things wouldn't have happened for me, you know?
Awesome.
So, and we're talking negotiations, we're talking closing deals, we're talking helping customers, we're talking making money. Okay. I'm not talking about anything weird. I'm talking about what we try to do to be successful in life, in our careers and everything. The spiritual side plays a big role, if not the biggest role, in what you're trying to do. And so if you can grasp that and learn how to, you know, put that in into its proper place, then everything else will fall in line.
So let me ask this question. You're talking about the spiritual part of that. As an entrepreneur, are you a tither?
Oh, yes, definitely.
That you mean? So, because a lot of people
don't. Tither and a giver.
Tither and a giver. I mean, it's a spiritual principle. It's a spiritual principle, and everybody doesn't grasp that principle. They want, but they don't how to involve God in what they're doing, you know, and that's a part of the covenant that he has and principles. You know, you're talking about giving as long as the earth remains, there's seed time and harvest, you know, those types of things are going on. So we got a lot of ground to cover, but thank you for that heartfelt expression of the spiritual, being proactive spiritually, and how you just said just today, if I hadn't have been proactive from a spiritual standpoint, navigating through my day could have been tough. I could have got off and off to the side, been pushed ashore rather than going forth and making headway and getting where I need to go. Stephanie, you want to add to one of those four places? We just talked about spiritual, physically. Can you talk about the physical demand on that person who's an entrepreneur?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Physically, you know, that applies to your natural body, and also even in mentally, but, you know, being prepared, being rested, you know, you can't make good, sound judgment decisions when you are not properly rested.
Okay.
When you know, have not, you know, prepared yourself, you know, like for me, if I was going to work in the restaurant industry, and, you know, when you're working in a restaurant, you know, there is no lunch break, you know, there is no, you know, sit down, take a moment, if you will. So you're working on your feet and you got to be prepared. You got to be prepared to make sound quick decisions. Okay. So getting your proper rest. Okay. Listen, eating healthy. You know, making sure that you're not putting junk in your body, you know, and a lot of times we'll say, well, I just don't have time. I got to get something quick, you know. So again, being prepared and knowing what your body needs in order for it to function well, you know, and I learned that because we don't put, you know, trash gas in our cars because we want our cars to do well. You know, we mm-hmm. want our cars to last longer. And so same way with your body. So being prepared, you know, physically, you know, having on proper attire, whatever it is that you're doing, you know, shoe wear, you know, those make a difference. Listen, I don't know about y'all, but when my feet hurt, my whole body hurts.
That's the truth. That's the truth.
I'm through. Them dogs get the barking. It's over. Yeah.
It messed up your attitude.
You know,
no reason, because your pinky toe is squished too hard, you know. So yeah. You know, being aware of those things, you know, physically, all of that plays a part.
Yeah.
And you know, eating well, resting well, you know, drinking water, you know, just taking care of your body.
Also, you got to deal with stress. You know, you need to exercise. You know, you got to exercise. You got to eat right. You got to rest right. Mm-hmm. And this is a part of me being effective, and I got to be proactive about these things. I got to know. I remember I was talking to G when he came out of working for someone else and he began to work for himself. I said, son, you're the sole. You have all responsibility on you now. You the CEO. I said, some of your friends that you are with, they work for other people. Now you the man. Everything is on your shoulders. Yeah. So some things where everybody else may be able to do some extra things, you got to say, no, I got to go prepare for my day tomorrow. I got big decisions to make. You know, I got all this responsibility on me. And whether you realize or not, there's a level of stress involved in it. And it's just real. It's just a real deal because as the CEO, if it don't happen, it's your fault. It's your fault. That's and right. Then you don't have employees. Don't have employees because now if you don't eat, they can't eat. And so everything is going down. So there's a lot happening. There's a lot going on. So
they got to eat before you.
Huh? Yeah. They eat before you do.
That's sacrifices. Right.
They eat before you do.
That's
sacrifices,
right.
You know, because you need them and so you got to appreciate them and listen. And you had a commitment to them.
Wow.
You got to have integrity now. And that brings levels of stress on you. So taking care of yourself physically, resting, exercise, it helps you making sure that you're not fatigued, that you're making good decisions, because you don't need to make a decision that cost you $500 when you needed that $500 to make payroll. Come on now. And when you're not at your mental capacity is not functioning well, you can do that very easily. very, very easily. Okay. So being proactive. Thank God Angela Watson is on. Amen. God bless you, sis. So good, so good, so good. She said, Lord help. She said, Lord help, all the way in East St. Louis. We thank God for her. Amen. And she can relate to these things. Mm-hmm. She was in that industry for a long time, restaurant world, and she's done a number of things. She's an incredible woman of God. She can relate to what we're talking about on this thing right here. So that's one thing, being proactive, being prepared spiritually, physically, financially, mentally. Okay. And then the second thing we want to add to this, and again, we're going over some of the 7 habits of highly effective people by Stephen Covey, with a little twist on it from Gerald Patterson Leadership Institute. Begin with the first, begin. Hold on. Let me pull this up. Being proactive. And then, do I have a vision? I'm sorry. Okay. Do I have a vision? You know, can I see the end?
Yeah.
Do I know where I'm trying to get to? Am I beginning with the end in mind? I know where I'm trying to go. I know we got to start somewhere, but do I have a vision? So do I begin with the end in mind? Do I know why I started? Because you don't even know why you started and where you're trying to go. It's easy for you to quit.
Ooh.
You didn't know where you were going anyway. You coming out, you
really
have the goal in set. So do I have a vision? So do you have any goals set? Do you know where you're trying to go? Can y'all relate to that?
Oh, yeah.
Let's talk about that. Do I have a vision?
I think even what we're talking about now, when you talk about having a vision and knowing why you got started, and listen, you got to remind yourself of that. Like, it has to be in the forefront. You know, you got to keep making sure that you're proclaiming the vision, speaking the vision, you know, talking about the vision and understanding what it is. And that causes you to set boundaries. That was one of the things that I was thinking about when we were talking about even these 4 things: physically, mentally, financially, and spiritually. And listen, those things, you can't just wake up one day and say, okay, I'm about to be, you know, prepared spiritually. You know, this doesn't happen on special days. It don't just happen on Sundays or Wednesdays. This is an everyday thing.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a process. And so just like your vision, you know, it's every day. All of your goals and all of your decisions should be geared toward completing that goal and geared toward that vision, you know, and so that causes you to set boundaries. You know, I'm not going to make a decision or start doing something else that's going to deter me from the vision.
Okay.
And I think that that's important too, and knowing those things and setting those boundaries so that you can continue to be effective and not, you know, wear yourself out.
Okay. Good. G, you have anything on vision?
Not much. I mean, I just think that, you know, when you have a vision, you have to set goals, you know, to line that vision out.
Right.
Because a lot of times we'll be trying to chase our vision, but we'll be just going in any kind of direction and we'll never truly fulfill what we saw.
Yeah.
But because we didn't take the time to, you know, plan out and really, really see God on what direction we need to go. You know, if we saw it, you know, I'm a true believer, is if I see it, I know that it's mine. I know that I can achieve it. But, you know, the direction's not always clear. And so that's when the spiritual has to come in and we have to learn how to seek God and say, okay, God, you showed me this. I know that this was from you. It confirmed what I've always felt, or it confirmed what someone might have spoke to me. It confirmed, you know, just it can be confirmed in different ways. But, you know, how do I get there? You know, and that's the key, is having a road mapped out, you know, and sometimes that map will change. You know, sometimes, you know, you might have to exit left sometimes, you know, you might have to take exit 1C on Highway 45. But, you know, at least we know, okay, we're headed in the right direction. We've made some way. So,
yeah, that goal, yeah. I say vision, goals, and strategy.
Uh-huh.
Goals is to measure whether or not I'm being effective. If you're not achieving any of your goals, you know you're not being effective. In order to achieve goals, you got to have a strategy, as you said. A strategy is a plan of action in order for me to achieve my goals. Goal mm-hmm. is a place of measurement to see whether or not I'm being effective. Mm-hmm. And so Melissa just said you can't always share your vision because sometimes the opinions or disbelief from other people will deter you from it. Wow, that's powerful.
That's a good point.
That's an excellent point. Excellent.
I got a comment for that.
Okay.
I think in the wrong environments that happens.
Okay. That's but good.
In the right environments where you can be cultivated and sharpened, because the word of God tells us that iron sharpens iron. So I think that if that is happening, okay, because it does happen, if it is happening, that is an indication that you're in the wrong environment.
Ooh.
You might need to change out your inner circle or get around some people that belong on your bus or belong on your boat or that's connected to your vision. So again, because we're talking about being effective versus being busy, and that will keep you in the rat race. You'll keep you in that spinning the wheel. And, you know, once you get in the right environment, you'll begin to see that people are for you and they mm-hmm. celebrate you versus tolerate you. So that's the indication that, you know, you may need to look at the people that are around you. You're only as great as the people that surround you.
Yeah, that's a great point. And then other things is I found true is this. Sometimes it happens just to see if you believe.
Oh, wow.
Yourself. Because if someone else can make you
quit,
stop believing in your vision, then you didn't believe it either.
Oh, that's good.
And so listen, I believe in this firmly. All things are working together for the God. I'm glad you know that. But if it changes my pursuit of what I say I saw, of what I know God wants me to do and what he has empowered me to achieve, I got to look at me then.
Wow.
If I happen to stumble into that environment or don't know that environment is really where it, I thought you were for me, but I find out you now, if it changes my heart concerning what I said God said or what I said that I know that God wants me to achieve, then that was an issue with me. And I don't take it personal. Always remember this. It ain't personal. It's purposeful. So you serve your purpose.
Yeah.
You sharpen my saw. Come on now. You mm-hmm. sharpen the iron, sharpen as iron. You sharpen me. You rub me the wrong way. And you just made my vision get clearer and sharper and my faith grow deeper. I'm digging in now. Come on now.
And Bishop, you know, you gave these four, you know, being prepared physically, mentally, financially, spiritually, but also relationally too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's dealing with relationships because I believe that the vision that we have, like, your vision can never be complete by yourself. Like, there are people that God has assigned to our life. And we have to be prepared to receive them to complete the vision that we need to get done.
Now, see, y'all getting on out there now. You're talking about synergizing now.
Yes.
And all of those things are important. And I always teach this. Listen, when God wants to bless you, he sends a person or persons in your life. When the enemy wants to destroy you, he sends a person or persons in your life. And you've got to be, because your vision is clear.
Okay.
And because the scripture says in Proverbs 29:18, where there's no vision, people perish. One translation said they cast off restraints or they're demoralized. Mm-hmm. When your morals and your integrity and your disciplines and things begin to change because someone was added into your life or people or an environment was added into your life, you've got to be so committed to vision where it pulls you back from that. And you got to say, you know what? This is more valuable because this vision discloses purpose and purpose discloses my destiny. If I get out of the will of God or what God has purposed for my life, then I'm doing life on my own.
Oh, wow.
Wow. Aaron was on last week and he says, there's some people, I love everybody, but there's some people I cannot allow myself to become attached to, or they attach themselves to me because their values aren't the same. I have principles now that I have to live by. There's things, you know, that I know, disciplines I have to have in order for me to continue moving forward. And what I know is true concerning my life.
Wow.
And so that's heavy there. And that's why also when there's vision present, you deal with identity crisis. Okay, that's where you begin getting clarity about who you are, you know, and what your purpose is in life and all those things. We don't want to get into that lane because we're going to get into a whole lot of other things. But yeah, where purpose is not known, thank you, Dr. Miles Monroe, abuse is inevitable. Mm-hmm. We talked about being effective is making sure that we accomplish a purpose. And I believe that entrepreneurs are born. I really, really do. I believe they're born. It's something about an entrepreneur. An entrepreneur is like a pit bull. I mean, they see a thing, they know a thing, they take risks, they're not fearful. Everybody cannot do it, but that's okay. It's all right to be a number two person. It's all right to be a supporter of a vision. It's all right, you know, it's all good. But then there are some that are just made to be out front, and their lives and their things, their disciplines that they have in their life, this at a whole nother level. And that is why they're able to achieve. The next level of your success is going to be based upon the disciplines that you develop in your life. Mm-hmm. The disciplines,
yeah,
the level of commitment to what you know is true concerning your life.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my,
that's good.
And so, seeing the end,
mm-hmm.
seeing the end, and identifying, you'll know. G said you'd say sometime the strategy has to change. You know, if I'm supposed to be traveling north, but now I'm traveling west. Because I've gotten distracted. I got to be disciplined enough to say, no, I got to get back traveling north.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I'm not going to get to where I need to get to. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Powerful. So begin with the end in mind. Vision. Vision, vision, vision. Here's a third thing.
Mm-hmm.
That's great. Do I put first things first? Do I put first things first?
Do you know what goes first?
Well, this is something that I say. This is a phrase. Are you willing to work hard before you play hard?
Okay.
Here's one of the 21 irrefutable laws of leadership. The law of sacrifice. You got to give up to go up. Are you willing to give up in this season of working hard, learning how to work smart, learning how to be effective, learning how to be making sure that you're being profitable? Because remember, entrepreneurs take a gift, take a service or a product, and they turn it into a business, and businesses make profits. And am I just having money pass through my hands, or of what I doing as an entrepreneur, is it being profitable? And then if it's being profitable, amen, do I know what to do with that profit? And I don't think that now it's time to play just because I made a profit. Or is the vision large enough to I know what I need to do with that profit in order to get to my next goal?
That's some heavy stuff there. First things first.
First things first. Work hard before you play hard.
What'd you say, G?
I mean, it's definitely truth. I mean, and that's the thing, you know, a lot of people, I like the question that you asked, do you know what comes first, you know? I like it because a lot of people in business and in entrepreneurship, they don't know. They haven't taken the time to figure out. They know they want to do something. They know they want to make it happen, but they haven't taken the time to say, okay, but what is the first thing I need to do? A lot of people will jump out there, they'll have a great idea. They'll jump out there, just start promoting a business or promoting that they offer a service, but they hadn't even done the preparation and they didn't realize that, okay, before I do this, I need to have this much money saved. Or I need to have, you know, this relationship in place. I need to have this building in place. I need to have
type of equipment.
You know, my right. It shocks me when I see, you know, people trying to do a service, and I'm not throwing any stones, but it kills me when I see someone trying to promote or offer a service, but they haven't even taken the time to build the initial investment that they need to be successful in that service. You know, when I started my cell phone repair business, you know, I didn't just jump out there promoting that I could do it. I had the skill. I gained the skill and I could definitely offer the service. I didn't have any money saved up yet. I didn't have the tools that I needed, you know, didn't have a business card, you know. And so before I did that, you know, and it took, a lot of people.
Uh-oh.
Man, that's how you know it was getting good.
It was just getting good.
Yeah,
he got that in Jesus' name. He got bumped off.
Yeah,
he got bumped off. But Sister Charlotte Polk says, "Give up to go up."
Absolutely.
Yeah, give up to go up. Amen. He's coming back in now.
Okay.
But that's for sure. Hey, here he comes. We letting him back in now, y'all. There we go.
Somebody called my phone, y'all. Sorry, somebody called my phone. But
okay,
if I can jump back in real quick. You know, when a lot of people know my testimony as to, you know, what motivated me, because it was something I was never planning on doing, right? Mm-hmm. But I heard a word, and then but when I heard that word, I just didn't jump out there and do it, okay? It was some time from the time I heard that word, and then I had to see it. It was still some time before I jumped out there. You know, I had to make sure that I had the tools that I needed. I had the, you know, I had to take some time to set myself up before I walked off of, you know, my
9 to 5. Uh-oh, there you go again.
They trying to get in touch with him.
Mm-hmm.
Can y'all hear me now?
We can.
Sorry. But, you know, before I walked off of my secular job, you know. And so, you know, it's just preparation, you know, making sure that, you know, you lay the foundation. Sometimes there has to be foundation laid. And there's been some times where I've jumped out and done some things and didn't lay no foundation. And I suffered the consequences from that. And, and you know, being an opportunity. Yeah, I mean, but being an entrepreneur, I don't even regret those moments. And right. I don't scold other people who I talk to about entrepreneurship when they've done that. I don't scold them or make them feel less than for doing that. Because right. that's, like you said, an entrepreneur is born, and sometimes that's just that, you know, that hunger inside of you that's saying, you know, I'm finna do this. I'm about to do this. You know, I don't care what nobody say. But logically and realistically, and this, I get this temperament from you, Dad. You know, I'm a realist, and so I'm always realistic before I make a move on doing certain things, because I know that, okay, if the foundation isn't laid, the house will fall.
Mm-hmm.
No matter how good you are, no matter, you know, how skilled you are in a certain area. And so, you know, just being prepared and laying that foundation is very important. You know,
one of the things I want to encourage someone, listen, we believe this right here, and we're going to lead into the fourth thing and which produces a public victory is you never fail. You learn. And so you, as an entrepreneur, you don't have to be beat yourself up, and don't let other people beat you up, because, you know, you went for a thing. You jumped off the porch, man. You jumped off the porch. You might have rolled in the dirt a little bit, shake the dirt off you. You find out, hey, you don't jump off the porch like that. But you know what? A person with experience don't have to be subject to a person with an argument. You didn't fail. You learned.
Yeah.
You didn't fail. You learned. Okay. And so all of these things are going on. And also, you know, one of the things I want to say, too, one thing you can always keep in mind, if you do have a talent or a product or service to offer, and you know, you're not going to be that person to just jump off the porch. Don't quit your secular job until it puts a demand on your life to where you cannot do it anymore. This is that law of sacrifice, Sister Charlotte, giving up to go up. Now you can't go out to dinner with the guys or with the girls or the bowling alley or these different types of things because you know what? You're working two full-time jobs possibly. And then when you are done with that, because your entrepreneurship, your business is starting to take off and now you're resting when you're not working. And so there's a period of time, a season of sacrifice. And you got to explain to everybody around you, hey, listen, I'm working on a goal, so I may not be around for a while. You know, and things of that nature, because I'm working on something. I'm going to get there. And when I get there, I promise you, you know, we're going to have a great time. I'll take you out to dinner. We're going to celebrate. We're going to do all those things. Don't feel pressured by others that don't understand what you're doing while you are pursuing your goals and going for the idea, the entrepreneurial idea that you have. Yes, Stephanie, you were going to say something.
I was just going to say what I hear, and this keep coming up to my mind, to my spirit, man, is that some of the things that G was talking about and some of the things that you were just alluding to, those are birthing pains. And your vision goes through seasons. And so you have to allow the vision to be birthed. And so knowing that and understanding where you are, like, so when we talk about, sacrifice, you know, giving up to go up, you know, there will be times that you have to give up, you know, whatever it be with friends or, you know, just doing different things because you're in the process of birthing your vision. You're in the process of, you know, getting clarity for your vision. And so, like you said, you never, you know, fail, you just learn, you know, so that's a growth pain. And so understanding that and knowing that, you know, the vision will speak to you. And so there will be moments that you may have some dry spouts, but that doesn't mean give up. And that's why you have to be prepared, you know, financially and spiritually and mentally, because it's a process. You know, when a woman gets impregnated, you know, she doesn't have the baby the next day. You know, there is a seed that is implanted. There's a process of growth and development. And so your vision will develop as well. So you have to be mindful and conscious about developing personally, you know, for your vision in order to, you know, to speak to others as well.
Yeah, sometime what we'll do is, thank God for Bishop E.L. Warren, we'll talk about the 12 seasons of every vision. And because visions do go through seasons and everything. And we'll elaborate on some of those points. I believe it'll bless you, it'll help you and encourage your heart. Amen. Because one of those seasons is death.
Come on, Bishop.
But after death comes resurrection.
People need
Amen.
To know that.
Yeah. They do need to know that. They do need to know that. And sometimes they think because it didn't work out the way they thought it should, that it's never going to work. No, you learn what didn't work. Mm-hmm. Okay. And that leads us to the next point, you know, that what I want to mention to you is do I think like a winner?
Oh, wow.
Do I think like a winner? Okay. Do I have a positive attitude? I always win. I never lose.
That's right.
Okay. What you see as failure was a learning experience for me. I'm going to take this and I'm going to build upon it.
That's right.
Okay. Yeah. I'm going to build upon it. So do you have a winning attitude? Do you think like a winner? Okay.
You know, that's
action. Come on, talk about it.
That is so important because, you know, I wanted to say this too. You know, being an entrepreneur, you know, we're talking about, you know, giving up to go up, you know, be prepared for who's going to walk away from you.
Oh,
you have to be prepared for that. You have to be in a winner's mindset. A winner wins by all means necessary. And if he has to win alone, look at Jordan, flu game, 97, I believe. Look at him. He had to win that thing on his own. And, you know, mm-hmm. He had his tools, but when everybody else wasn't stepping up, Jordan had the mentality of, I'm going to win. Y'all got to go watch The Last Dance, by the way. I'm just now on it. I know it's been out a while. The Last Dance, man, have you fired up because Jordan had that winner mentality of, I'm going to win if I got to do it by myself. And that's a winner's mentality. But even more so, you have to be prepared for who's going to walk away from you while you're going through those different seasons in your vision. You know, yeah. A lot of times you'll find yourself alone. You'll have people commit to doing things and saying, hey, I'm going to support you. I'm going to do this and that. And they never show up when it's game time. You know, wow. And what I've learned in entrepreneurship, I cannot depend on anything but my faith in God and my ability that he has given me to get what he put in this earth for me to get done. And that okay. sometimes is a lonely road. Now, on the flip side, like we said, there are people that you have to include in your vision. And when you meet those people, you'll know who they mm-hmm. are. You'll be able to pinpoint it because they'll think like a winner too. And it's crazy yeah. because a lot of people, the people that are for you, they think like a winner in your vision and they don't even have a vision for themselves, but they want to win in your vision. Mm-hmm. You know, they want to be successful, you know, and we know this guy who I want to mention and he won't mind me mentioning his name. My man, Jonah. Okay.
Yeah.
I rebuked it.
Come on. We're going to get him on camera in there. He's usually on the move. Yeah. He's going to come back in a minute, but we're going to get a camera live. But this having a positive attitude, thinking yeah. like a winner.
Yes.
You got to ask yourself. I'm talking about habits of highly effective. Do I think like a winner? You know, we know we hear things like my attitude affects my altitude.
Right.
We know all of those things. We say it, but do we really comprehend what that means and have that become a part of my DNA? Has that become a part of my DNA? I think like a winner. I always ask this question. How do successful people think?
Mm-hmm. Like God.
Like God thinks.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You know, God inspired the word of the Lord to be written that says, all things are working together for good for them that love God and who are the call according to my purpose.
Right.
He had that word Amen. Inspired. So, you know, God thinks like a winner. How do successful people think? Like God thinks.
Wow. That's right.
You know? Yeah. Come on and finish what you're saying. You was talking about Jonah.
Yeah, I'm sorry, y'all. I'm a wanted man today.
Business.
We're gonna get you a camera in there. We got 2 minutes, guys.
But what I was saying real quick, I added Jonah to my vision, and he was only there for a season. But when I tell you that he wanted to win so bad and just helping me, and you guys even seen it, he actually created the intro to this show for
That's
us.
Right.
And so this young man was so motivated to win that once his tenure was done with me, I was able to set him up and launch him into his own business to continue doing what he was doing for me for himself. So yes. when those people come to you, when they're added to your vision, you'll know who's the one that's supposed to be there because they'll have your mindset. They'll have God's mindset and they'll want to win for you as well as for themselves.
That's true. That's the truth. Guys, this has been a powerful conversation today. We're going to have to pick up on this next week because we got to finish this out. And Sister Charlotte Polk says that's good because the people who you think will help you won't. It's not who you think it is. It's who God sent to serve you and your purpose.
That's Amen. Right, Mama.
Amen.
I call Miss Polk Mama. She Amen. Knows who I am. I know her son for a long time, so.
That's right. That's right. Great people. Great people. And so listen, guys, we appreciate it. We appreciate all the comments. We appreciate those. Listen, share this. I believe that some of the things that we're saying, like I said, we don't know it all. We're sharing experiences. We're sharing what God has shared with us to do the things that we're doing right now. And so share it. You know, it can help somebody. Please go out, subscribe to our YouTube channel, Gerald Patterson Life Lessons. And these videos are out there to be re-seen, listened to 94.7 WKIU, KBN, Kingdom Broadcasting Network. They're being re-aired on Wednesdays at 5 p.m. Central Standard Time. All right. So listen, we love you. Thank you. God bless you. And we will be back next week. And we pray that all of you can get back on and you can share it with somebody they can get on to. Amen. Remember, are you effective or just busy?